Hey y'all, Ramdino here, coming at you again for another Appalachian Trail community news, thru-hiker update, and trail information. Well, the 2023 thru-hiker season continues to march on. The bubble is heading very quickly now to a conclusion up in Maine there at Baxter State Park and at good old Mama K. So there's lots of folks heading that way right now, lots of folks that are in Vermont, New Hampshire, and Maine particularly. So we're going to have a ton of folks that have that'll be summiting in here in the next few weeks. We're already up somewhere north of 250 Nobo thru-hikers that had summited. So that is awesome, and that's just going to continue to climb. So let's look at the folks out there that are reporting in this week that we've been tracking, and they've been giving us updates along the way. So we got Lolly and Pop. They are currently in the 100-mile wilderness, somewhere around 50 miles from Katahdin. And so they're hoping to summit somewhere around Tuesday or Wednesday. And they say that things are starting to get better mud-wise up there, so it's been getting better all week, but I saw where they are starting to gonna get some more wet weather moving in up there, and I brought it inside today because I'm getting wet weather here, so it's going to get little muddy up there, but I don't think it's right now we're going to have any kind of near the flooding issues that we had even close to what we had a few weeks ago. Patriarch, he is past the summit of Q Mountain, and he's taking a zero because we had some rain up there at the Hiker's Welcome Hostel there in Glencliff, New Hampshire, and he'll be getting back on the trail. Said he passed the ice cream man's house, Bill Ackerley. Of course, Bill Ackerley passed away back in May, but the new person who owns that property now is continuing that tradition, and so he's serving up ice cream and fudge pops and all kind of neat cold things like that for hikers when they come through. So whoever the new guy is, appreciate you doing that and following that tradition. And then Patriarch says he will be hiking Musilaki either today or tomorrow. Lucky Colleague, he has had a few days that he took a zero, maybe a Nero and a zero. He said that they were reflecting on the passing of Steady Eddie. So obviously that was a little while back, a week or so ago. But kind of made me feel like that when he says they, that means that affected a large group. And he was around that area when Steady Eddie passed and was taken by the flash flood that he got taken by. And so, but it seemed like a lot of folks in there kind of had PTSD from not only the flash flooding, that all of a sudden it came up on them, even though they knew there was a significant rain coming, and a lot of people tried to get off trail, but sometimes you don't know it's coming. You don't have, that connection on your phone. You're out there in the backcountry, and next thing you know, you're having a flash flood. So that's probably what took Steady Eddie. And then also other folks that are around him, but for the grace of God, go they. So that's very easy to get caught up in that. So they were reflecting on that, and it seemed like that was something that was really, really troubling to him and some folks around him up there. The through hike marches on, and so he is said that thoughts go out to Steady Eddie's family. But he's in the Bigelows now, gearing up for the 100-mile wilderness. He said Maine is rapidly becoming his favorite state. He said the saddlebacks were fantastic, and he says that the trails are fair to hikers. So I guess he means they're exactly what you would think when you get up there and you see some other folks' videos, the level of difficulty, but not only the level of difficulty, but also the beauty and the majesty that you see up there of creation in the mountains and everything. So appreciate that report, Lucky Colleague. Blade Runner, she is heading into the White Mountains. She's on her Sobo trip, and she is definitely seeing a lot of Nobos, she says. She says the trail and the weather are pretty good right now. She did see two moose the other day, so that's awesome. And she can't wait to climb the Presidentials. She also ran into some folks that have been reporting in here each week, and that's McDuck, the Okie, and JFK. And she ran into them in Bethel, and she said they bought her dinner. So that is awesome, guys. Appreciate you doing trail magic while you're out there doing a thru hike. And speaking of McDuck, the Okie, and JFK, they have started the approach trail together on February 28th. down at Amicalia Falls State Park, and they have hit the Maine border now on July 31st. So they say they are having an amazing adventure. BD, she has summited at Katahdin on her flip-flop, and she is now flipping back south. Cobweb Rose, Mountain Crusher, and Snapshot, they are in New Hampshire, or should be very close, if not in New Hampshire by now. They did report in that they got caught in some terrible thunderstorms and lightning up on top of Mount Killington. So, once again, weather moved in rather quickly, and they weren't expecting it. And so they said it thunderstormed all afternoon. They got poured on and hailed on. And I can tell you, I've been caught out in a hailstorm before, and it can be just the size of BBs, much less marbles or golf balls, and it hurts. Golf balls will probably kill you. But the lightning strikes, they said, was very close. That is also scary. Got caught in one of those up on in Grayson Highlands one time, and so much so it was in the middle of the night, and I'm running hunched over, and the flashes, I could see my silhouette on the trail. So that is all just scary to be caught out in one of those. She said the trail ran for 6 miles down Killington Mountain, and it was terrifying. They thought they were going to die. I'm sure they did. So thankfully, everybody made it down okay with no injuries, no lightning strikes. And they've hit the 1,700-mile mark, and so they are less than 500 miles to Katahdin. So that is awesome, Cobweb Rose. Bubbles has made it to Vermud, and she says it got down to 47 degrees last night. So that meant that she's from Florida. She's not used to those cold temperatures when all you've got is your summer gear, so she is getting her winter gear back. She said the mud puddles are like puzzles to solve, as well as the rock scrambles, and she's loving it. So, yeah, when I'm not, my socks are not wetted out yet, I'm trying to figure out those puzzles as well. But once my socks get wetted out, there's no point. You're spending more energy trying to get at them. You might as well just barrel right on through them. Honey Bun has made it to Great Falls just past the 1,500-mile mark. He says the heat wave has finally broke up there in New England, but the last few days of humidity and flies and mosquitoes has been brutal, and he has absolutely appreciated that new bug net he's got. He says the trail is pretty much dried out from the Hudson River on up to that point, and all crosses are easily done and all's going well, and he should be getting into Massachusetts any day now. So we did have a summit from a group that was our husband and wife that we have been tracking the whole time, and they've been reporting in, and that's Jeff and Mila. So congratulations to them. They said that they were 4 days shy of a 7-month journey. So as we've been reporting the whole time, they have been having a great time taking some side excursions, and I think just enjoying the trail, squeezing every bit of life out of it they could all the way up. And when they left Amicalia, they were hikers number 17 and 18, so they started really early. Harper's Ferry, they were number 38 and 39, and at Katahdin, they were number 248, and summit number 249. So congratulations to them for that summit, and thank you so much, guys, for sending in your updates and allowing us to be part of your journey the whole time. They did come down on the A-Ball Trail down from Katahdin instead of coming back down the Hunt Trail system. They had looked at it, and they thought that that would be a shorter trip. However, they said it turned into more of a rock scramble all the way down. So not real sure that they would recommend that to other folks, that it would be that much shorter. Probably looks like it's a whole lot more dangerous between that and the knife edge. They both look like they're pretty intense coming down. They did want to give a quick primer on what would be the best way to make sure you can get into Birches there, the Birches campground. So they indicated the best way to get there, because at Birches, they only allow 12 hikers from what they've indicated there. I thought it was 20, but it may be 12. But in any case, they only have a limited number of people that they let there at Birches campground. And if you don't stay there, then your trip the next day to Summit is a lot longer. So they indicated that they found the simplest way was just to, in order to stay at Birch's, was to stay at A-Ball Pines Campground the night before. They had some camping cabins there. They also had showers, laundry, basic resupply. Of course, at this point, you're not really going to need much resupply because you're done just about. But they also said that breakfast, well, basic breakfast was included as part of your stay there. And they said that was the best way to do it because then you would go up and early the next day and get your reservations at Birch's. They said the ranger down there told us if we leave Birch's that they would lose their spot for the next day. So that was, they found out, was the best way to do that. So they stayed there at the A-Ball campground and then they secured their spot for Birch's. And that way they would have a shorter day instead of a 20-miler the next day up to Katahdin. So those are the folks that have reported in. Anybody else out there wants to report in, be glad to, even if you haven't been reporting in your whole trip, if you want to start or just let us know that you've summited, that would be awesome. And you can do that through all the links down below in the description section there, either through an IM or email. Any of those work great. And, of course, you're welcome to send any pictures along the trail or maybe even a short video, but especially your summit pictures, and let us know there what your numbers were when you summited so we can keep track of those and see how many folks have summited. So before we get to the news portion, I did want to give a huge super thanks shout out to some subscribers and viewers that gave me a super thanks out there. So we got Jason Spears, 1246. We got Kay Bontrail, Wendy GRW, and Melissa Koger all sent me in a super thanks. So thanks a lot for that. That is a way that you can tangibly support this channel and the mission of this channel and what I do out there to help the hiker community and just to do my part for it. So thanks a lot for that, guys. Really appreciate that. If you're somebody that wants to do that in a tangible way, the link to the super thanks is right under the very directly under this video. Of course, you can become a Patreon member as well. That always helps. And then of course, your comments. Love your comments. Any questions you got out there, send those questions in or just a comment. Appreciate your comments. Thumbs up drives folks to this channel so that you can be a part of helping me grow the hiker community and help the hiker community. And then, of course, also your subscriptions help that as well. So any of those help out the channel and help what I do for the hiker community. And then I want to really especially send a thanks out there to all the folks that told me that they are sending in prayers or good thoughts for my friend Darren, who is dealing with glioblastoma, which is basically a brain cancer that with a limited life. He has a limited life expectancy because of that. So he's undergoing treatments now, and I've shared that with you before. He's a lifelong friend of mine. So I want to thank you for folks that have sent in that you indicated you're praying for him or sending good thoughts for him and even for me personally when I'm out there on the trail and just what I do. So thanks a lot. That means the world to me. That all that positive energy flowing my way and flowing his way really helps out. So I just appreciate that. For folks that do that. I had, when I was out in Massamud, Massachusetts, a couple weeks ago, people would come up to me at on the trail and indicate the same to me. So that means a lot to me. So I greatly appreciate that. So, but let's get to the news now. So some news we got going out there. Ewok, she sent in to the AT Bridge, which is Sobo of Vermont, number 12, has a reroute at it, and that's it. Nobo mile 1,732.9, she says. She says when she was there, she saw several hikers that were using it. It looks like the bridge itself is intact, but the abutments on each side are not, so it's kind of a kind of a scramble up to it. You could get hurt, but quite frankly, there's a lot of rock scrambles that are a whole lot worse than that everywhere. But nevertheless, it is an official reroute. You're not supposed to be using it. Don't know what the reroute is, if it's a road walk or if it's some other ancillary trail that got around there. So if you know what that is, leave a comment down below if where that reroute starts and where it ends. And if it's a road walk or if it's a trail walk that folks are doing out there. And then our typical Northern correspondent, Whispers, he just wanted to send in, said his observations are the rivers and the creeks up there have all returned back to normal and certainly decreasing in the last few weeks from the highs they had in June and July. They've been getting a little bit of rain, but not enough to keep them flooded like they were before. Certainly not at the torrential downpour rains that they were. So he says things are looking up out there. He's seen a good number of Sobos in the Northern Whites and the Mahoosics, and says that maybe folks now are starting later with all the rain that had happened. So maybe that's why Sobos are kind of late getting started this year. And he's also been seeing a lot of late March Nobos, those that started late in March, as did I when I came to that area. He also mentioned that he had a great trip in July, that he went up there. He has some annual buddies of his that they do some trail magic, and they actually take a stove, I mean like a grill, that they take it into the backcountry with meat, 20 pounds of meat, he said, and fruit. And they take all that back in there to a campsite around the Zealand Hut and the Ethan Pond Shelter there in the Whites, and they cook for hikers that were out there. So that is pretty awesome trail magic, to be in the middle of the wilderness, up in the Whites, in the middle of nowhere, and then somebody shows up with 20 pounds of meat and fruit and cooking it for you there. So that's awesome. So appreciate that, Whispers. And then Rick Lawrence sends in that Emory and Henry College there in Virginia, they have a semester on trail program, which is the only program in the U.S. that you get credit for hiking the Appalachian Trail. So I think it's part of it's a learning component of their outside, whatever the outside degree is that they have up there. So it's part of that with hiking and exercise. And so that's pretty cool that they do that. Hey, you can go out there and get college credit for which college credit equates to not having to pay tuition dollars. So it pays to go hike the Appalachian Trail if you're a college student. Unfortunately, you have to be at Emory and Henry College in Virginia. And then shout out to Spineless Cougar for doing trail magic up there in Vermont. He had came down, and you saw in my Vermont video there, where he came down and did it in Massachusetts when I was coming through there. So he typically is up in Vermont, and he sends us the pack weights that he gets from his hikers. So he did it, usually does it at least once a week. And so on Tuesday he was there, and he had about 31 hikers that came in through there. And he had about, and then 17 on another time he was there. And so he had 40 Nobo, 6 Sobo, and 2 long trail hikers that came there at his trail magic. So he has folks weigh their packs. And he had a few flip-floppers as well. So those that weigh his packs, so he had an average of around 27.9 was the average, and the median was around 28. So the median and the average was right there at the, you know, pretty much even with each other. And there was more folks that had 35 pounds than that was kind of the mode, which means that's out of the sampling that was done, that was the most poundage that, you know, numerically, that there was more people carrying the 35 pounds than any other particular weight. So he had a high of 43 pounds. Somebody was carrying 43 pounds, and a low of 17. So obviously that high of 43 is more than twice, about 2.5 times what the person carrying 17s. I always wonder, what is that person carrying in the 43 pounder that the 17 pounder is not, and the 17 pounder is surviving just as well. So, in any case, thanks a lot, Spineless Cougar, for sending that in. And then a shout out to Popeye. He was a thru hiker from 2022, and he has turned into a trail magician, he calls it. And I call them trail angels rather than trail magicians, because they're trail angels that do trail magic, but he calls himself a trail magician. So he's said this is the third time he's done it this season. Then there, he's somewhere around Route 25A in New Hampshire. And he had around 46 hikers that came through there. So that is awesome, Papa. I appreciate you being a trail angel or trail magician up there. And then starting on August 7th, which is tomorrow, the ATC, the AMC, which is the Appalachian Mountain Club National Park Service, they will be replacing the Henderson Brook Culvert there at the Katahdin Ironworks Road there with a bridge. So that's at mile 2113.8. So that road is going to be closed to vehicular traffic for the duration of the project. There has already been a reroute around there, and I think that reroute involves a fording of the stream. So if you're a hiker that's come through there lately, leave a comment down below what that reroute is around the Katahdin Ironworks Road closure up there. And then I had a community question that came in, and one of the community asked a question, and one of the subscribers asked a question in the comment section. Want to know, is it okay if a hiker takes a bar of soap into the river or creek or lake to take a bath? And so my opinion of that is no, it is not okay to bring a bar of soap. Now, you can buy organic stuff like Dr. Bonner's here. That's all natural, non-GMO, but even that should not be taken directly into a stream or a lake. Even this, it being all natural, still going to change the pH, still going to got some stuff in it that animals, crayfish are susceptible to it, and fish and small fish and other things, smaller creatures that the fish eat are not, or could be more susceptible to a change in the dynamics of the chemical makeup of the water, that this would change, even if it's all natural. And certainly I don't know of any bar soap that would be all natural. I know they have some that may say they are, but they're still going to introduce stuff to the lake or the stream or the creek. And then certainly people downstream are going to be drinking that, or animals are going to be drinking that. So no, that was a good question, but no, it is not acceptable to do that. If you're going to use soap and you need to have some type of all natural soap, some type of biodegradable soap like Dr. Bonner's, and Dr. Bonner's don't sponsor this, and he's not giving me a dime for that, but this is what I use on trail. You need to be 200 yards away from the stream and use it very sparingly. Dr. Bonner's is, you got to really dilute it because it's very concentrated. But you can use it for brushing your teeth, washing your dishes, washing a dog if you got him out there on trail, or washing yourself as well. And just to be honest with you, most people don't take baths on trail. I know that sounds odd, particularly for people that are not hikers, but we just stink when we're on trail, and we're all just used to it. The only thing we really smell is those folks that are day hiking. We can smell those folks coming a mile away because they smell all nice and purdy. But most hikers, it doesn't bother them one bit. You just stink, and that's just the way it is. So you're out there on trail, you're having a good time. It's not a fashion show. Other than being the biggest thing that we clean, that we wash, is our hands, right? Because we're eating with those and putting them in our mouth, around our face and stuff. So you want to keep those clean. But other than that, most folks, they wait till they get to town. If they're doing a long distance hike, they wait till they get to town, to take a shower or something like that. Certainly just jumping in the water, a lake or stream without any kind of soap or anything, you're going to leave an oil slick, believe me, but that's probably the best way to do it. You can get pretty clean just doing that. Water is the greatest solvent there is out there. So, and it's all natural, non-GMO. And then for those folks that have asked about my chickens, well, my chickens have finally got their act semi together, and they have started laying eggs. So not all of them have. That is a tiny, tiny egg. No, I don't have tiny, tiny chickens. That is just normal for them. They lay tiny eggs until they learn how to lay bigger eggs, I guess. But that is an immature chicken egg, but it eats just as good as a mature chicken egg. And it's funny. So I've started eating them, and I had myself scrambled eggs the other day, and even these small ones have double yolks. And that's not unusual, from what I understand, to have double yolks when they first start laying eggs. So they're right at 20 weeks, but that's a different channel. If you care about that, any of that at all, I have another channel where I do some homesteading there. We have kind of a micro homestead here, Trail Boss and I, so I'll leave a link right up here to that. You can go and check that out if that's something you're interested in. So, and then I hope you are enjoying my Massa Mud trip. So I have those videos also will be linked at the end of this video. You can go and check those out. I've got a few more to drop from that, but I have got almost all of those done. That was a really neat hike. Enjoyed that, but glad to be home from that hike. It was hot, muggy, and muggy out there. So good to be back home in the land of flush toilets and showers. But I'll be getting right back out there again, but not in Massachusetts. I'll be continuing NOBO on up through Virginia, and I'll be starting that, probably be on that hike a long weekend, about a 3 or 4 day, doing 35, 40 miles toward the first week or two in September. So that's in central Virginia, right there at Black Horse Gap at the Bluers Parkway is where I'll be starting and heading north from there. So, hey, if you want to come out and join me, you can send me an email, probably the best way to do that. Send me an email, and that link's down below. Be glad to have you along. Be good to have other folks out there hiking with me that are part of the hiking community and just enjoying that. All right, folks, that is all I've got this week. As always, appreciate you, and we'll see you out there.